Buonasera a tutti, benvenuti a questo evento che apre questa iniziativa che abbiamo lanciato per i 150 anni di Ca' Foscari, per l'anniversario, le celebrazioni, una delle tante, una delle più importanti per il rilievo e l'eco che ha e per i contenuti che porta con sé. È l'iniziativa che prevede l'invito a personalità di grande rilievo, ai premi Nobel, è la Nobel School di Ca' Foscari che vedrà frequentare le nostre aule, quindi a lezione, in lectures tipo queste, sei premi Nobel nel corso dell'anno. Oggi accogliamo il primo di questi ospiti eccezionali, Bole Soyinka, che vi invito a salutare con un applauso. Premio Nobel per la letteratura nel 1986. È stato con noi in una conversazione, devo dire, bellissima per l'intensità che ha dimostrato in quell'occasione alla chiusura di Incroci sabato. Ed è di nuovo oggi con noi per una lezione magistralis in cui toccherà alcuni dei punti che ha scelto per intrattenerci e per comunicare, per dialogare con la comunità e con gli studenti che sono qua e con i nostri colleghi che sono qua. A Bole Soyinka seguiranno altri ospiti della Nobel School: Robert Merton, Nobel Prize winner per l'economia nel 1997, Amartya Sen, sempre per Nobel Prize per l'economia nel 1998, Robert Engel ancora per l'economia, Marius Vegas Losa per la letteratura e Thomas Sargent per l'economia. È un'iniziativa che abbiamo voluto per le celebrazioni, volendo dare alle celebrazioni una chiave non solo celebrativa del passato, ma una proiezione nel futuro per dare enfasi al ruolo che vogliamo che la nostra Ateneo abbia negli anni a venire, idealmente nei prossimi 150 anni e comunque nei prossimi decenni, quindi coinvolgendo personalità di grande rilievo nei campi che sono la storia di Ca' Foscari e gli elementi caratterizzanti, per coinvolgerli in eventi che nei quali possono entrare in dialogo con la comunità cittadina, con il pubblico e partecipare direttamente alla didattica, al rapporto con gli studenti. Per gli studenti queste saranno occasioni speciali perché al di là del rilievo scientifico, della profondità scientifica del pensiero di queste persone, c'è una personalità, un carisma che abbiamo già visto nella conversazione di sabato sera e che evidentemente permea le personalità di questa levatura. È un'esperienza quindi straordinaria che diamo a noi stessi, che diamo ai nostri studenti, e ne siamo profondamente orgogliosi e siamo profondamente grati a chi ha permesso la realizzazione di questo programma ed in particolare la Fondazione di Venezia, che ci sostiene come sponsor principale d'iniziativa insieme a The Bowers, il nostro partner che ospita, è un nostro partner storico di Incroci e ospita e contribuisce quindi al sostenere l'iniziativa e ospita i premi Nobel nei propri palazzi. Io ringrazio tutti voi per essere qui, passo la parola al professor Gregori che darà una introduzione e farà l'audazio per Bole Soyinka, che come gli altri Nobel che seguiranno ha accettato, e siamo felici di questo, di essere parte della comunità larga di Ca' Foscari, accettando la nostra Ca' Foscari Honorary Fellowship che gli verrà conferita come parte di questa cerimonia, a cui poi seguirà la sua lezione magistrale. Grazie di nuovo e buon ascolto per la lezione.
Buona Buonasera a tutti, anch'io ringrazio tutta l'organizzazione per questo evento e darò lettura di una breve presentazione di Wole Soyinka, che non ha bisogno di presentazioni, quindi io mi scuso fin d'ora, diciamo, per coloro che conoscono bene la sua opera, se sarò un po' pleonastico rispetto a quanto già conoscono, e implicitamente dunque della Laudatio per l'Honorary Fellowship che verrà conferita tra qualche istante. Nigeriano Yoruba, nato nel 1934, premio Nobel per la letteratura nel 1986, Akiwande Oluwole Wole Babatunde Soyinka, Wole Soyinka, è una delle voci più potenti, originali e trascinanti dell'Africa contemporanea. Come già stato detto, è stato insignito del premio Nobel per la letteratura nell'86, il primo intellettuale africano a ricevere questo premio. Un riconoscimento importante, doveroso e forse tardivo, non tanto nei suoi confronti, ma nei confronti dell'Africa che tuttora è troppo sottorappresentata nel pantheon dell'Accademia svedese. Ma Wole Soyinka, come ci ha ricordato Alessandra Di Maio, la nostra collega e amica palermitana, massima studiosa di Soyinka in Italia, tra i massimi esperti mondiali dello scrittore, e che mi permetto di ringraziare fin da adesso, è qui con noi, ha intervistato Wole Soyinka sabato, vi prego di fare un applauso. Dicevo, Wole Soyinka è molto più di un Nobel, da sempre impegnato contro la dittatura, ogni dittatura, quelle del suo paese come quelle delle tante, troppe nazioni. Soyinka è stato condannato in gioventù a ben 22 mesi in cella di isolamento e successivamente è stato costretto per due volte all'esilio forzato per sfuggire a una feroce condanna a morte. Con lo strumento della parola, con l'arma gentile e sottile del discorso raffinato e allo stesso tempo potente, Soyinka lotta per la giustizia e per i diritti degli uomini e delle donne, facendosi portavoce degli oppressi, delle minoranze, dei condannati della terra, dei popoli e delle persone che sono costrette a vivere un'esistenza a livello inferiore, a una non esistenza, in troppi casi. La sua parola afferma la comunità, il popolo, ciò che ci accomuna al di là dei confini, sia quelli fisici e politici che quelli molto più difficili da varcare e da riconoscere, delle nostre mentalità, delle nostre abitudini, delle nostre paure e delle nostre false idee. La sua capacità di attingere ai miti e alle tradizioni della sua gente, di confrontarli e mescolarli con quelli di altre culture, costituisce l'essenza della sua scrittura e della sua instancabile attività culturale, che vuole sfociare in un'impresa, tra un po', tra qualche mese, mai tentata prima e di portata universale. È un'impresa, come ci ricorda proprio Alessandra Di Maio, che consiste in una traversata di artisti, attivisti, pensatori, scrittori ed esponenti politici che i primi di giugno navigheranno tutti insieme sul Mediterraneo per raccontare l'altra parte della storia che lega l'Africa e l'Italia, quella che i media non raccontano, non dicono, concentrandosi per lo più sulla disperazione degli sbarchi. L'Italia, l'Europa e l'Africa sono intrecciate da sempre, in realtà. Da sempre si sono scambiate storie, scambiate leggende, merci, materiali preziosi, artefatti e divinità, in pace e in guerra. Secondo genito di Samuel Ayodele Soyinka, un pastore anglicano e direttore della St. Peter's School in Abeokuta, la sua città natale, e di Grace Eniola Soyinka, un'attivista in favore dei diritti delle donne nella locale comunità, Wole Soyinka crebbe in una comunità fortemente radicata nella cultura Yoruba, in un contesto religioso fondato sul sincretismo e sulla tolleranza reciproca, un contesto che egli, pur agnostico in più tarda età, mantiene sempre e manterrà sempre sullo sfondo della sua opera e delle sue convinzioni più profonde di tolleranza e rispetto, come sentiremo anche oggi nella sua lecture. Dopo gli studi universitari compiuti in Nigeria, Soyinka completa la sua formazione in Gran Bretagna, nell'Università di Leeds, sotto la supervisione di George Wilson Knight, profondo conoscitore del teatro e delle opere di Shakespeare, e si dedica lì, già in Gran Bretagna, al teatro, al Royal Court Theatre di Londra. Alla fine degli anni 50, Soyinka inizia a scrivere le sue prime e già importantissime opere teatrali, tra cui The Swamp Dwellers, The Lion and Jewel, The Invention. Rientrato in Nigeria grazie anche a una research fellowship dell'University College di Ibadan, Soyinka pubblica testi per il teatro e poesie e diventa co-editor di una importante rivista letteraria africana, Black Orpheus. Nei primi anni 60 insegna letteratura inglese allo University College di Ibadan, un incarico che lascia nel 64 per protesta nei confronti dell'azione coercitiva e intimidatoria nei confronti di docenti e ricercatori imposta dal regime. Nel 1965 viene arrestato per presunte attività antigovernative e viene rilasciato solo dopo alcuni mesi, in seguito alle proteste della comunità letteraria internazionale. Negli anni 60 scrive altre opere teatrali che verranno rappresentate nel mondo con enorme successo, tra cui Before the Blackout, The Detainee, The Road. Durante la guerra civile del 66 e del 67 Soyinka deve nascondersi per evitare la prigione, ma nel 67 non riesce a sfuggire alla cattura e viene confinato, come abbiamo già detto, per 22 mesi in un carcere di massima sicurezza, dove tuttavia continua a comporre poesie e altri testi e persino a tradurre in inglese il romanzo di un compatriota dalla lingua Yoruba. E questo nonostante la situazione di isolamento e di estrema difficoltà, nel quale Soyinka non poteva avere a disposizione nemmeno gli strumenti essenziali per scrivere, come carta, penna e libri, un destino, come abbiamo sentito, a incroci di civiltà, condiviso con il keniano Ngugi Wa Thiong'o, che è qui con noi questa sera, che ringraziamo di essere qui con noi. Grazie a un'amnistia, alla fine della guerra civile, Soyinka viene liberato. In seguito si ritira in una sorta di esilio, questa volta volontario, in Francia, per trovare tranquillità e pace interiore. Qui continua a produrre un ampio numero di poesie che vengono raccolte nella silloge A Shuttle in the Crypt e altre importanti opere teatrali. Inoltre continua a farsi portavoce e sostenitore impegnato per i diritti umani e della protesta nei confronti dei regimi dittatoriali. Nel 72 pubblica il suo secondo romanzo, A Season of Enemy, Stagione di Anomia, che ha altrettanto successo quanto l'aveva avuto il fortunato The Interpreters del 64. Inoltre pubblica la sua prima raccolta di opere teatrali, Collected Plays, per la Oxford University Press, presto seguita da una seconda raccolta, sempre pubblicata a Oxford nel 74. Nel 77 scrive un adattamento dell'opera da tre soldi di Brecht dal titolo Opera Vognosi, e nel 1981 l'autobiografia A Che, The Years of Childhood. Nel 1986, come abbiamo detto, riceve il premio Nobel per la letteratura, come si legge nella menzione dell'Accademia degli Svedesi, per aver dato forma al dramma dell'esistenza in un'ampia prospettiva e con toni poetici. Nel 1988 pubblica la raccolta poetica Mandela's Earth and Other Poems. Nello stesso anno diventa professore di African Studies and Theatre nella prestigiosa Cornell University negli Stati Uniti. Negli anni 90 Soyinka continua a produrre opere teatrali e romanzi. Viene nominato ambasciatore culturale dell'UNESCO nel 1994 con la missione di promuovere la cultura dell'Africa, i diritti umani, la libertà di espressione. Eppure questo non impedisce al governo nigeriano del golpista generale Sani Abacha di accusarlo di alto tradimento e costringerlo a un secondo esilio forzato nel 1997 per sfuggire a una feroce condanna a morte che scuote le coscienze e produce una massima riprovazione da parte di tutta la cultura internazionale. Anche a seguito di questi eventi, Soyinka scrive una commedia satirica, King Babu, in cui mette alla berlina i regimi dittatoriali dell'Africa e coloro che nel mondo occidentale li sostengono direttamente o indirettamente. Terminato l'esilio, Soyinka continua a scrivere varie opere poetiche di prosa, tra cui il testo autobiografico You Must Set Forth at Dawn, pubblicato nel 2006 e recentemente tradotto e ripubblicato, ancora più recentemente, tradotto da Alessandra Di Maio e ripubblicato, come dicevamo, nel 2016, in una nuova versione. In anni recenti il professor Soyinka, come egli giustamente chiede di essere chiamato, ha lavorato e lavora come scholar in residence alla New York University, nell'Istituto per gli Studi sull'Africa, continuando a produrre importanti pagine di saggistica e di studio sulla cultura africana e prodigandosi per il riconoscimento di un continente ancora troppo dimenticato e per la difesa dei suoi abitanti, oggetto di troppe persecuzioni e di un'odiosa quanto ingiusta discriminazione culturale e sociale nei paesi ricchi, paesi del cosiddetto primo mondo. Scioinca ha continuato la sua attività di strenuo difensore dei diritti umani al di là di ogni confine. L'anno scorso, a questo proposito, è uscita per la casa editrice 66 and Second una raccolta di poesie, Migrazioni, Migrations, da lui ideata, in cui i maggiori poeti nigeriani e italiani versificano sui rapporti fra l'Italia, l'Africa e il Mediterraneo. Tra le sue opere teatrali più note, disponibili ai lettori italiani, rimangono La strada, La morte, Il cavaliere del re, Il leone e la perla, Pazzi e specialisti, La riscrittura delle baccanti. Vi sono anche Abiku e altre poesie, e Ogun Abibiman, le raccolte di saggi, mito e letteratura nell'orizzonte culturale africano, Clima di paura, Il peso della memoria e dell'Africa, i volumi autobiografici già citati, Ache e Isara, che coprono gli anni dell'infanzia, e il recente Sul fal del giorno, appunto, You must set forth at dawn. E, last but not least, l'ormai classico, L'uomo è morto, in cui Scioinca racconta gli anni di carcere durante la guerra civile, che è stato appena ristampato in Italia. Non voglio concludere, sto arrivando alla fine, non voglio concludere questa breve e fin troppo essenziale sintesi della intensa e profonda attività di Wole Soyinka con mie parole, che sarebbero del tutto insignificanti e poco adatte a descrivere e commentare l'opera di una persona tanto grande e tanto importante. Lascio che siano le parole dello stesso Soyinka a concludere questa mia breve introduzione, per la quale ancora una volta ringrazio Alessandra per avermi fornito materiali e spunti, con parole tratte da una sua poesia, raccolta in una piccola antologia preparata dagli amici di Pordenone, dedica nel 2012, anno in cui Scioinca fu ospite di questa rassegna culturale. La poesia si intitola, la leggerò in italiano, I figli di questa terra. I figli di questa terra sono vecchi, con lo sguardo fissano mappe e mai la terra. Coi piedi imparano a seguire contorni lontani, tracciati da menti aliene, con un senso del presente svanito nel passato. I figli di questa terra sono fieri, ma solo in apparenza. Camminano per aria, ma sia chiaro, fu il suolo per primo a ritrarsi dal tenero tocco dei loro piedi nudi. Un tempo la terra era loro appartenenza. A testa alta, con aria fiera, avanzano verso i corvi all'orizzonte, tra nuvole e locuste. I figli di questa terra, occhi immensi nelle orbite, sono teste con corone di spine di pesce pulito, la cui polpa passata tra porte a vento è servita tra chiacchiere fredde e vino fresco. Ma sono occhi che fissano il vuoto, oltrepassano il presente, penetrando i varchi oscuri del mondo dei vivi. È la progenie dei spodestati, degli spodestati, spogliati della speranza e della terra. Lo spregio supplisce i legami filiali. I figli di questa terra sono naufraghi in scafi cavi, pelle di tartaruga e squame, callosità della placenta andata. Le mani sono artigli per radicarsi. Le lingue divulgano leggi nuove e codici sociali. Una razza nuova scalzerà il presente, in cui l'amore, bandito come estraneo, vaga solitario tra foreste perlustrate per brama, seguendo le orme ferali del potere, in cui l'amore è un vecchio rudere, isolato, calpestato dalla memoria, in un presente derubato di presenza. Ma i figli di questa terra stringono tra le braccia il vuoto come amanti. Le spore della loro unione popolano spazi un tempo umani, aggirando agili fantasmi della paternità. I figli di questa terra vestono la toga dei giudici, con sguardo che rigetta i metri del passato. Un barlume invade fugace i loro occhi spenti, lacera l'aria con una domanda sola: chi ha venduto la nostra giovinezza? Grazie, professor Scioinca. Invito il professor Bugliesi a salire per il conferimento della Honorary Fellowship.
È il momento formale in cui leggo la motivazione e poi inviterò il professore a salire. Noi, professore Michele Bugliesi, rettore dell'Università Ca' Foscari di Venezia, proponiamo di conferire il riconoscimento di membro onorario del corpo accademico dell'Università Ca' Foscari a Wole Soyinka, nato a Beucuta il 13 luglio 1934, con la seguente motivazione, ovvero in considerazione del premio Nobel per la letteratura ricevuto nel 1986, dell'importante ruolo culturale, sociale e politico delle sue opere poetiche, narrative e teatrali per l'affermazione di una letteratura africana in inglese, del suo impegno per riaffermare la vitalità della cultura del suo paese e dell'Africa nel contesto mondiale, per sostenere le culture delle minoranze e delle persone messe ai margini delle società e delle nazioni. Conferiamo a Wole Soyinka il riconoscimento di membro onorario del corpo accademico dell'Università Ca' Foscari, Venezia, il 9 aprile 2018. Professor Soyinka, please come to stage. Ora leggo la motivazione in inglese per il benefit del recipient. The Ca' Foscari Honorary Fellowship is awarded in recognition of your Nobel Prize for Literature awarded in 1986, the important cultural, social and political role of your work in poetry, narrative and theater in promoting African literature in the English language, your commitment to strengthening the vitality of your home country and Africa worldwide, and your support for minorities and for the people left behind by societies and nations.
This is a very great, unexpected honor. I only got wind of it a few minutes ago, and which is just as well. I might have fled because of this prestigious university, but thank you. So now, Yoruba Roma, romancing the gods. It is an avoidable waste, surely, to consign the ancient gods to obsolescence. It betrays, in my view, a weakness of imagination in societies which regard them as spent forces, no longer serviceable in one way or another. Of course, we should not expect such retentions to be found in the same form or diffuse the same essences as in time past when they were first admitted into or fabricated from human consciousness. All objects imbued with any measure of vitality metamorphose, so we should expect no different from those entities known as deities. And then, look at the competition. The reigning substitutes that answer the seemingly insatiable appetite in humans for objects of veneration, or as I like to put it, of romancing, these are pop musicians and soca stars. These also, however, find themselves in keen rivalry with their multi-millennia counterparts of the spiritual realm, especially the so-called charismatic preachers who feed off the relegated gods in garish rituals of mass excitation. You may have encountered them in full flight. They see visions at the drop of a coin, churn out so-called healing miracles to hold on to believers, and turn them addicts of the optimism roulette. I'm certain that they're very present here in Italy from various nationalities. We certainly have them spread all over the continent of Africa, from Nigeria and Senegal to Malawi and South Africa. Some end their credentials by the most bizarre impositions, the likes of which were unknown even in medieval culture of trial by ordeal. Such, for instance, is the case of a South African charismatic prelate who compels his followers to swallow live snakes and other exotic items from his spiritual menu. Those who find this difficult to believe, I would like to turn to the all-comer YouTube facility for recordings of live sessions of such ministries, or even browse through the African media in any nation. Sometimes these charismatics join forces to expand and economically manage their zones of influence, thus minimizing expenses and maximizing profits, just as in multinational corporations. The spiritual commerce sometimes results in takeover bids and hard-headed negotiations, just like the business people across national borders. Now, when I first wrote the play, The Trials of Brother Jairo, in the early 60s, to be followed some years later by what you might call a military version of it under the title Jairo's Metamorphosis, I may have thought that I was being merely satirical, just trying to ridicule the progressive hypocrites of our society and their manipulations of the human spiritual instinct. I keep calling romancing the deities. I never imagined that I was being extremely restrained at that time in my prognostications. Today, however, even heads of state traverse the continent to kneel at the feet of the latest prophet Jairo to seek their blessings and solicit prophecies for their contemplated careers of rule or misrule in their various nations. The army of the hopeful, faithful proliferates and dominates both social and business environment. And this is despite of ethical scandals of mind-boggling dimensions, or to name just one very notorious case of criminal neglect, not so, just about a year ago, the lapse of the so-called Tabernacle of Healing, whose headquarters in Nigeria came tumbling down, entombing nearly 100 worshippers from all over the continent, mostly of them from South Africa. Enemy action? No. That was simply the result of the failure to observe those very useless rules of building, structural balances and so on, or even obtain a permit for the building in the first place. The result of the inquiry was damning. But that has not circumscribed, staunched in any way, the surge of believers. It's a miracle. Most of these charismatic, they produce nothing more than very bad stage and television theater. Melodramatic, but literally unbelievable. And yet they draw mammoth crowds, and they supersede even the soccer stars and pop musicians in television rating. Forbes magazine had to sit up and take notice and measure their wealth against the regular business multi-millionaires. Colorful and energetic, most of them are basically harmless, and perhaps one should just leave them severely alone to minister to and or fleece their gullible flock to their heart's content. However, another strain of this same divine charisma transports us to a far more sinister terrain and makes the foregoing, the earlier ones, most benign, even saintly. We're speaking now of another tributary, but of the same monotheistic fount that proves to be far more hideously inimical to well-being and even humanity's very survival. It's Cleric's claim, with the other charismatics, the same ultimate power source and focus on veneration. That godhead, which they romance, in the hands of this second strain, appears increasingly addicted to human agony. The screaming evidence of this contemporary reality can be no longer denied. Tucked away into infinite cosmos, the original godhead itself seems to recede and recede, and to be constantly, however, despite being invisible, in constant need of human blood transfusion. From Somalia and Nigeria, on the African continent, to Chechnya, Iraq, and Syria, and allied beleaguered scenes. It is this same banner of a supposed universal omnipotency that, it is claimed, inspires and confers legitimacy on whatever action they choose to inflict on humanity. Such are the strange gods that are prescribed for our time, but they have moved beyond being merely clerical servitors and become aspiring gods in their own right, no matter how stridently the lip service emerges that they publicly pay to a supposed higher power and declare him to be the one and only on behalf of whom they operate. They are no longer guides and apostles to the spring of Godhead. They are themselves the gods. They brook no dissent, tolerate no scriptural variation, countenance no competition, and abhor the very notion of human plurality and the spirit of inquiry. Their sole response to any of such contestations is kill. The kill because this mortal space that you and I now occupy must be cleansed of impurities for their occupancy as the chosen. And we, unbelievers of this new homicidal dispensation, are embodiments of those impurities. Our colleague, the Ghanaian poet, novelist, Kofi Awuno, died under a hail of bullets from their divine guns in a Nairobi shopping mall. Numerous writers, cineasts, and artists are falling to their now. Thank you so much. Is it water or wine? Is there something below? Right there. Actually, I don't think there's so much thirst. It's okay, it's balanced. Yes, I was talking about the general human sacrifices that go to the worship of these new, the veneration of these new gods. And not just writers. The ancient libraries of Timbuktu barely escaped their purifying fires. The University of Maiduguri in northern Nigeria was closed down for years after faculty members were gunned down, while the University of Agriculture in Kaduna mourned for ages those students who were called out one by one from their dormitories one night and executed one after the other. For some inside authoritative career of these new gods in action, or of the divine alibi that they claim to serve, as it affects the daily lives of his creatures, those it most concerns, there's no shortage of witnesses and literature. And so testimonies emerge not simply from the horse's mouth, so to speak, but virtually from the very vents of the furnace. Such is Wafa Sultan's A God That Hates, or Karima Benunez, excuse me, your fatwa does not apply here. Let us simply plant a summative brushstroke or two on the portrait of this overweening spirituality that is currently ravaging the African continent and the Middle East, the Far East as well, for that matter. The black-hooded monotheistic attestation that attempts to replace both the Islamic bowl of ablution and the Christian baptismal font with execution blood pits from east to west and north to south. I would simply sum it up this way. Some scriptures claim that God created man in his own image, perhaps. What is not in dispute, however, is that these ministers of the latter-day religion have created God in their own image. Now, all communities, be it nations or professions, have their own share of psychopaths. The religious profession is no exception. The problem that the world has yet to overcome is the continuing deafness to the screaming necessity of evolving comprehensive strategies for neutralizing a godhead that is so manifestly a creation of psychopaths. We shall not stay long on the morbid side, I assure you. The foregoing is simply to register and then bypass one of the many provocations that nudge one to revisit from time to time those gods that were clearly never creations of psychopaths or of hate, whatever their failings or inadequacies, even in their own time. Where such so-called ancient gods are still very much alive and vital to a number of societies, a cursory review of deformities in the monotheistic track record responds to and rebukes derogatory inferences, such as, I quote, the pagan Hindu deities, African demonic worship, the primitive Germanic gods, pagan Rome, or the heathen Greek pantheon from which the Roman derived her own divinities, and other pejorative variations of the same attribute allotted to them in history, in religious and anthropological literature. Speaking for myself, and for at least a modest sector of humanity, I'm sure, I never cease to marvel how the word pagan ever came to be associated with primitivism or the pre-dawn of spiritual illumination. However, along with that observation comes also a contented feeling of identity, of association with a special geography of spiritual sensibilities, which despite historic harassment, has survived the depredations of time and neglect. The much denigrated gods remain to remind humanity that the so-called world religions that have replaced the now derided paganistic phase are mere elaborations of the imaginings of humanity about a universe that it has yet, in fact, to catalog, explain, and systematize in entirety. In short, that such religions are mere reifications of the human acknowledgement of mystery, which, thank goodness, proves to be near inexhaustible. The true ground, of course, is veneration, real and false romancing, fabricating structures that feed off the law of supply and demand. Humanity, it does appear, needs to venerate or to romance something. And there is no shortage of seasoned psychologists and marketers ready to fulfill that need. The difference then between then and now, between what is sometimes termed ancient and modern, reveal all the centuries of often magnificent contrivances, the product of specialized skills, and that, however, must be enthroned as objects of romancing, pushed further and further into the receding horizons, then into sheer ether, and finally into a nowhere of elaborate mystification. In the process, humanity is plunged deeper and deeper into bondage to that unknown, arbitrated by increasingly power-hungry, that is, politicized priesthood. It is one such experienced class of priesthood that is taking on the world today, a possessed priesthood whose acolytes are poised to decimate all of humanity if they cannot mentally and spiritually subjugate and reshape that humanity in that their own image. After all, they have already reconstructed the supreme Godhead in their own image, so how dare mere mortals dispute their supra-creationism? Now, there are many ways to contest this renewed menace that lays claim, sole claim, to the universe of spirituality. As a poet, dramatist, and teacher who takes his material comfortably, both from the real world and from the mythological, I can only call attention to a habit that derives from the principle of education, both the formal and informal. And in this context, it recommends a retention of a comparative attitude towards the so-called pagan beginnings. Or perhaps we should simply use the expression pagan ancestry, since the word beginning suggests that we are now in a phase of ascending human progression that has transcended a very rudimentary starting point. That, of course, may be applicable to many nations of the world, but certainly not to all. We cannot confine ourselves to societies where such beginnings have become remote, where they're no longer part and parcel of daily awareness, where the physical representations are to be found only as ornaments for urban fountains occupying alcoves in public and private buildings such as this, as mere mythological residua. Of course, we encounter them all over the place. They fill museum spaces as permanent residents, except, of course, where they are boarded up at the approach of a visiting dignitary from a rivaling spiritual domain. Their owners and custodians being such generous, accommodating hosts that they avoid giving offense to the spiritual sensibilities of their august visitors. Such an event did take place not so long ago, right here in this nation, may I remind you, and belongs to that corrective sector of informal educational process that I earlier recommended. And this is my last, I promise you, reference to this event, unless, of course, there is a new provocation. That event was a gratuitously wasted opportunity that should have impressed upon such visiting vectors of spiritual closure, however politically or commercially potent, that the world we all share does not belong to, nor is it to be viewed through their own spiritual prism alone. I imagine that for many Italians, that event was a minor blip on the template of human tolerance and accommodation. For us, on the outside, constantly facing the fire of intolerance, incessantly ravaged, however, let me simply adapt the words of the first man to walk on the moon's surface. a small step backwards for Italians, a giant step again backwards for humanity. Never show tolerance to the intolerant. To return to our main theme, however, let me reiterate this. There is no serious harm done if a society loses the spiritual references of its physical symbols from the past, spiritual precipitates, be these registered in wood, clay, marble, metal, stone or fabric or whatever. Time dissipates essence, distorts even literal meanings. But in the name of all the gods that ever existed or were merely imagined, should a society totally deny its past, reject it in entirety? Well, even here, let us concede, perhaps, why not? That is the nature of human inquiry and discovery. Society discards debris that no longer serves her purpose, or when such a purpose, which also translates sometimes as vision of the future, is contradicted by ancient retentions. No contest there. However, selectivity is all. Thus, we should exercise caution in our blanket dismissal of what once existed as a human device, be it as a practical solution to challenges of quotidian existence, or as purely conceptual holding devices for managing the metaphysical imponderables of awareness and imagination, which include, for many, fears and insecurity engendered by the very enigma of afterlife. The gods are part of this system of conceptual scaffoldings. We know that we do not need to persist with the mythology of Vulcan in order to advance technology until we reach the stage where we can actually catapult one of our own protagonists into those rarefied domains where Vulcan's forge is presumed to be located. The god Orishauko of the Yoruba has taken a back seat to the pharmaceutical factories, and today, even remote controlled scalpels can be wielded across continents to perform the most elaborate and delicate operations. That deity of herbal intelligence and mystic incantations, Orishauko, has yielded to the all-knowing diagnostician who will prescribe their multicolored pills and potions or refer your case to the nearest specialist. He or she may then decide to cut you up in little pieces and then sew you back together. None the worse for wear. It's all known and applauded as progress. So are the ultra-modern sewage disposal systems, the gleaming gadgets, flush toilets, mechanism with electronic eyes, chemical treatment, and even recycling, etc., etc. These all are now taken for granted, even in some of the remotest hamlets of advanced societies. So one can understand why very few Romans, or indeed Italians, even school pupils, ever heard of the deity Cloacina, the ancient presiding deity over Roman sewers. If the system breaks down today, the presiding deity is the Minister of Health, and he loses his portfolio. Nonetheless, who can swear that during the reign of the Emperor Tiberius, certain technologies for sewage disposal embedded in some of the ritual celebrations of Cloacina may not offer us, even today, unsuspected solutions to some unprecedented malfunctioning? Outside such technological probabilities or improbabilities, however, Cloacina remains a powerful social metaphor for that fate which many of us in our various societies often wish on some breed of politicians, to be physically flushed down the toilet, or perhaps, failing that, symbolically pelted with mock sewage during a procession at the festival of Cloacina. The deities in extremis remain serviceable, even in the psychological terrain of mere wish fulfillment. We should not discard metaphors that potentially offer a measure of relief, may arouse public awareness, and may even assist in galvanizing, on occasions, social remedies and movement, and above all, supply raw material for writers, poets, and other mythologists. But more seriously now, and in any case, as we shall shortly see, that deity, Glochina, is even more complex than on surface appearance, just like a number of other deities that we shall encounter during this voyage into a past that is ever present. For even while we call attention not only to the physical existence of reminders of pagan past, the word pagan, of course, always in inverted commas, we need the constant qualifier that there are societies that remain vibrantly paganistic in attestation and practice, albeit approached by outsiders as exotica. The truth is that in such societies, they are no more exotic than the trails of pilgrims to Lourdes, or the Kaaba of Mecca, or the Wailing Wall of Jerusalem, or the River Ganges, and other centers of spirituality to which millions flock in and out of season. They are no more exotic than the numerous centers of Buddhist temples or shrines to Shinto gods and Hindu avatars. Sometimes we refer them to them as invisible religions, which again is prejudicial, since they are visible. They are invisible only to those other religions whose spread and, frankly, aesthetic assertiveness render them visible and striking even to non-believers. What should be kept in mind, however, is that some of these invisible religions offer us humanistic values that are sorely needed in widening spaces of a world under siege. At the very least, and sometimes unexpectedly, they actually relieve the tedium or stress that the modern tempo of sheer survival impose on many, including even accidental encounters, such as I never miss an opportunity to narrate. The following comment, however, on all these encounters needs observing, but perhaps we should hardly needs observing, but perhaps we should state it anyway, just to make sure it is not missed. All this has nothing to do with whether one embraces or rejects the mythology from which a cultural practice has stemmed. That is the lesson that should have been served on that Philistine head of state who demanded and was granted the boorish demand that realistic portraits of Roman gods be covered up when he visited the National Gallery in Rome. Or perhaps he should simply have been led to the shrine of Glochina under some pretext or the other. Surely there must have been a time-weakened spot in this soakaway, the shrine towards which he should be accidentally steered, and that should be the fate reserved for all loutish imperators of religion. It is in that very spirit of ecumenism, which is at the heart of human coexistence, that we now proceed to evoke here as a humanistic touchstone one religion that has successfully crossed the Atlantic from the African continent and implanted itself within another continent, developing even syncretic variants wherever it landed, South America and the Caribbean most famously. I refer, of course, to the religion of the Yoruba, a religion that is known as the Orisha. Stop over in Cuba or Brazil, in Colombia, Peru, Uruguay, Mexico, and lo and behold, there you'll encounter Orisha worship alive and thriving all the way from the coast of West Africa. One lesson of that sadly neglected goddess, Glochina, we have no intention of abandoning her just yet. That lesson is a largely suppressed convergence with another deity, Venus, who we all know is synonymous with the concept of beauty. It is a convergence that is central to the philosophical grasp of the world of the Orisha, the religion of the Yoruba, and it stands in very sharp contrast to the rigidities, the hermeticism that inform some of the so-called world religions. In Toachina, that we merely isolate her as a convenient exemplar, an accessible entry point to the Yoruba world, in Toachina, she's not as unique a phenomenon as it might appear, but there we do encounter the natural convergence of opposites or simply incongruities as the reality of the world we inhabit, and thus a caution against rigid dichotomies in the understanding of that world and by implication the gamut of humanity itself. The principle of beauty and the connotations of sewage in one single reification? Well, the implicit question is, why not? It's all prefigured in numerous deities of the polytheistic religions. The goddess Kali, again, from the Hindu, offers another instance. That principle is even invoked when convenient in some monotheistic religions. We needn't travel too far for illustration. The liturgy of vengeance in the same breath as love and forgiveness in the Christian scriptures. In my own Yoruba world, the most relevant deity in this respect is Eshu. We shall let him point the way as we now take the plunge deeper into the spirituality of that world. Now, Eshu, let us introduce him formally. You'll find him sometimes represented like a Janus figure, a face turned forward, the other backwards. Now, there are seven principal deities of the Yoruba pantheon, but Eshu is not one of them. Yet, he provides an accurate key into the world of the Yoruba spirituality. If we choose to continue with the parallelisms and divergences also, which are often no deeper than surface perception, Eshu warns us, do not deodorize actuality. Pollution and purification are merely two sides of the same coin. The fate of Eshu at the hands of the early Christian missionaries in Nigeria is also one of the most seminal in the history of religious encounters. There's only one word for their action, demonization. Well, that is also true, anyway, of the blanket attitude of imperious outsiders towards virtually all newly encountered religious structures. So it's applicable both to both Christian and Islamic evangelism. They simply cast all spiritual structures of the indigens into the pit of darkness and damnation, while they replace them, of course, with the luminosity and salvation of their own superstitions. The case of Eshu, however, often offers us a specific model of the missionary impulsion and the strategic approach. It happened as follows. When the missionaries arrived in the land of the Yoruba of the west coast of Africa, the home of the Orisha, may I remind you again, and they commenced their task of conversion, they felt handicapped because they could not isolate the concept of evil, of the devil, or Satan. It must have been a serious setback for them, since only through the strong implantation of the notion of sin could these heathens be made aware of the peril in which their souls stood, a peril that could only be warded off through conversion. Damnation and salvation. This twain formed the axis of the cross on which the heathen soul had to be stretched and then steered triumphantly towards the latter. And so, to impress upon these heathens their condition in sin and thus as damned, The early Christian missionaries desperately needed the services of an obliging agent, Satan. They examined all the deities and opted for Exu, which is spelled EXU in Brazil. Now, this is quite convenient, since Exu is the most ubiquitous of all the deities, being their messenger and a mischievous one to boot. Additionally, as we have established, Exu lends himself to the complexities of existence. No wonder his place is at the crossroads, from which vantage point he proceeds to confuse, sometimes, the wisest of mortals and even of the gods. If you walk through a traditional Yoruba town or village, you might see, still encounter today, a potsherd containing pieces of kola nut, some palm oil, and even coins. These are special sacrifices to the Lord of the Crossroads. They are supplications for his non-intervention in human affairs, or prayers for his benevolent patronage. Even during festivals of the principal deities, the first morsel is set aside for their outsider issue. And in commencing any ceremony, mortals consider it wise to implore Exu to please restrain his prankish temperament. Exu, however, is anything but evil. The notion is as absurd as to deem a high-spirited child a product of the devil. He represents the random, unpredictable factor in both divine and mortal affairs. Exu is, in short, the dialectician of reality, a cautionary spirit who teaches us that reality has more facets than one. Trust not to appearances. That is the core lesson of Exu. A lesson, alas, that is often imparted the hard way. It's not entirely by accident that, as you may have observed, I've quietly manipulated Exu into being our first encounter with those godly denizens as we approach the realm of the Yoruba pantheon. What other deities in that realm shall we encounter? We cannot go through them all, obviously, so I shall simply introduce one or two more, highlighting, however, the principle of decanting multiple aspects of human consciousness and tendencies, including the contradictory, into one vessel. So, prepare to meet Ogun, whose lesson in seeming contradiction is aptly expressed in the portfolio, in his portfolios, War and Meditation, Destruction and Creativity, the latter being mostly expressed in lyric poetry and the sculptural arts. Again, parallels are not in shortage in Asian and Greco-Roman pantheon. Ogun, however, has the distinction of being also the pioneering instinct in humanity. Hence, one of the best known praise names of his, he who goes first, even where others have turned. Mythologies are constructs, as constructs are not accidental. They are meant to cover both human and nature phenomena, but above all, to capture human desires and the will to transcend the apparent. Mythology often reveals how humanity attempts to control imponderables rather than the other way around. The deities themselves are thus presented as being in need of humanity, periodically at least, a need to partake of mortal essence. That is why they set out on that journey, only to find that chaos had intervened during eons of time, and only Ogun could create the primal tool to cut through that chaos and unite them to humanity. While on that subject of iron, metal, and alloys and all, and still employing Ogun as guide and paradigm, let us now move straight into that phenomenon I mentioned earlier, that is sometimes referred to as syncretism. the merging of the Yoruba world with the external parallelisms in the so-called new world of the American and the Caribbean. We begin to understand why it was so logical that the Yoruba religions and cultures from the African continent near uniformly, others near uniformly atrophied, while those of the West African coast, the Orisha in particular, of the Yoruba survived and in fact prospered. When the Yoruba encountered the Roman Catholic saints in the worship of the, when they found that their European masters were intolerant of their religion, these slaves who were already steeped in the universality of phenomenon, saw the saints as no more than channels and symbols of the spiritual quest, repository of the glimmerings of the ultimate truth. They were recognized, the saints, that is, were recognized instantly as intercessions to Supreme Godhead, bridges between the living, the unborn, and the ancestor world which shaped the cosmos of the Yoruba. The European plantation masters were hostile to any notion of African spirituality on the soil of the Indies and the Americas, and they forbade all references to them. Thought some of them were a little bit too belligerent. So that did not create, however, any problem with the slaves. They simply gave the saints new names and internally intoned the liturgies of their authentic spirituality. And the process went even further. It moved beyond internalization of spiritual allegiance, and it moved towards an appropriation even of the Christian symbols. This, of course, was because in response to the additional existence of the forbidden by the slave masters. I beg your pardon, this time not the forbidden, but the insistence on visible, palpable representations of the Roman Catholic religion. They insisted that these slaves put up the figures of the saints even in their paltry habitations. So the slaves display the images of the saints, but they address them again in parallel with the parallel names of their own deities. Thus, Saint Lazarus, Chokmono, Saint Anthony, Ogun, the Lady of the Candles, Oshun, Eshu itself, Baron Samedi, and so on and so forth. And this is what we continually stress. It never constituted a spiritual dilemma, since the system of the gods had always been one of complementarity, of affinities, and expansion. Expansion, but not of the aggressive kind. The saints, as you see, had of course long replaced the ancient Roman deities. So don't look out for Cloacina, for Neptune or Apollo, or in Brazil, or their equivalents in Cuba or Mexico. Look out instead for Yoruba names. For in the Americas, the saints did indeed go marching in, or more accurately, go sailing in with Christopher Columbus and his adventurers, but they ended up arm in arm with Yoruba deities, implanted firmly on the altars of the established Roman Catholic Church. And thus it rests, even till today. The children of this syncretic spirituality even travel on pilgrimage to Yoruba land, Ile Ife especially, to seek out the original source of the duality of their spiritual inheritance. And this brings up, this collaboration, this marriage, if you like, brings us to that hanging question, one that has become increasingly clamant with the current epidemic of religious intolerance and hatred on which thousands are impaled somewhere on this globe on a daily count. We ask the question, why is it that the worship of Orisha has never, in all these centuries, and even under hard conditions on foreign soil, spawned an irredentist strain? Neither a jihad, nor a crusade, nor their equivalents attached to the history of any of the Yoruba deities in the world. Indeed, the expression will not be found, will not be encountered in the language of the Yoruba, whose very ethos of worship is a profound ecumenism, a condition of mind that recognizes, to cite yet another Yoruba saying, Onokan Kowoja. This means more than one path leads into the marketplace. Just one more Yoruba explication of the human relationship with the gods, one that makes it impossible for any form of religious absolutism to take place over human choices and organizations. It goes, Beniosi Imale Olewa. If humanity were not, the gods would not be. One large speculative question is equally legitimately posed. In a society, that question is this. In a society where an integrated consciousness of the parts within an existential whole exists, where, for instance, a deity named Obatala champions the cause, the needs, the right to dignified existence of the blind, the maimed, the hunchback, or the albino, would it be possible to conceive of a doctrine of the supremacy of the perfect human specimen, a doctrine that led to the methodical disposal of quote-unquote inferior beings, that is collectively inferior race, resulting in the gassing of millions of humanity? Now, no one guarantees that the annual rituals of global sensitization will prevent notions of the presumed superiority of one human species over another. We do not claim that. We can, however, assert that religions which spout the equality of humanity under one benevolent deity did not appear to have prevented such horrifying reverses in human progression as the Holocaust. They have not, even as we speak, prevented ethnic cleansing of a people known as the Yazidi by religion-besotted entities who consider themselves the chosen, while all others are deemed as inhuman, subhuman, damned, and disposable. Not forgetting, of course, the ongoing fate of the Rohingya in Myanmar. And they have not prevented the president of one of the most powerful nations in the world to proclaim without blanching, allowing only the blue-eyed Norwegians. I don't want to see the backside of citizens from shithole countries called Haiti, Nigeria, Mexico, and other such species of subhumanity. As recently as 2 days ago, the New York Times struck another note of alarm on its front page, just 2 days ago, under the heading, Can We Stop Fascism? Or is it too late? That note, contributed by former US Secretary of State Madeleine Albright, goes thus. On April 28, 1945, 73 years ago, Italians hung the corpse of their former dictator, Benito Mussolini, upside down next to a gas station in Milan. 2 days later, Adolf Hitler committed suicide in his bunker beneath the streets of war-ravaged Berlin. Fascism, it appeared, was dead. To guard against a recurrence, the survivors of war and the Holocaust joined forces to create the United Nations, forge global financial institutions, and through the Universal Declaration of Rights, strengthen the rule of law. In 1989, the Berlin Wall came down, and the honor roll of elected governments swelled, not only in Central Europe, but also in Latin America. It seemed dictators were out and democracy was in. Freedom was ascendant. Today, we're in a new era, testing whether the democratic banner can remain aloft amid terrorism, sectarian conflict, vulnerable borders, rogue social media, and the cynical schemes of ambitious men. Mr. Trump and other leaders pose a threat more serious now than at any time since World War II. That's Madeleine Albright writing just 2 days ago. So down went the Berlin Wall, up comes, or at least still threatens, the Mexican Wall. Now, we all know it's not a one-sided, unilocalized story. The villains, leaders, both actual and aspiring gods, menace human survival and entitlement to dignity. We find ourselves pushed to a habit of what I call speculative immunology against a threatening affliction, seeking new or abandoned ethical constructs, even extracts, that might yield clues to a transforming agenda for the psyche of society and humanity. Bear in mind the actualities that we endure today. Children vanish under our noses, yet the deity, Kori, the god of children, not only exists, but is integrated into the daily consciousness of some people. Now, might such ethical symbols, if they were truly alive and effective, have rendered impossible the abduction, first of nearly 300 school children, mostly girl children, and the continuing entombment of half of that number in inaccessible strongholds? That outrage would be followed 3 years later, that is recently, by the abduction of yet another 110 in this very year, 2018. In short, I do propose that such a horrendous violation against the vulnerable would be inconceivable in a society where the essence of a shrine to Kori in communal consciousness has been thoroughly internalized and woven into societal undertakings. We have already admitted that there are psychopaths in every society, that is, deviants in all societies. And one should be not be so complacent as to claim that one's own society is totally immune. However, all we have to do is pore through history, even with a fine-tooth comb. We shall not encounter in our search a narrative in paganistic societies where the abduction and traumatization of hundreds of children is considered worthy of adult pursuit. Nor Chibok, nor Dipcha could have occurred in the authentic community that has been formed by the Orisha. Yes, let's talk Chibok, and let's talk Dapchi. And let us not forget Beslan, or indeed Kenya, where youths were massacred in their dormitories in the name of religious piety. But Dapchi today remains the most challenging, this most recent one, not merely because it's the most recent, most recent instance of failure in our humanity, but because Dapchi offers us, no, let me replace that word, offers. Dapchi imposes on us, on the world, a residual and incidental variant that goes beyond the particularities of doctrine and attestation, known as religion. Dapchi is that village where a young human entity was given the opportunity of liberation with her colleagues, but she said no, out of conviction, because the condition was that she convert and renounce her religion. So now, a mere 3 years after Chibok, another word has entered the global vocabulary of humanity's dereliction. As if that unfinished business was not sufficient, Chibok has been upstaged by this new chapter of, no other word can capture it, of abomination, this time in that village called Dapchi. The assault has attained a happy ending, yes, but one that is not totally finished. Its mission incomplete. The captives have been rescued, they've been restored, rather, but minus a tally of 5 who died in the course of the abduction, and 1 who said no. It is that one, a forceful reminder of responsibilities that humanity owed itself universally, that compels a re-examination of what beliefs are all about anyway, how they evolved, how they came to have such a tyrannical hold on social directions. But let us quickly insert this. Such incidents are not at base issues between one religion and another, but rest squarely on our perception of the human entity, either as a being of volition or of compulsion. In the process, it is useful to explore, as we have attempted to do, those zones, contemporary or from antiquity, where the seemingly intractable war for human tolerance and against the tyranny of doctrinal enforcers appear not to have taken such deadly forms, be this in the theocratic field or the secular, and no matter in what area of human undertakings. One said no, so her captors kept her behind. It is sad that the heroic roll call of victims of monstrous choices, male, female, young or elderly, continues to swell. Where it involves the young especially, the rebuke is overwhelming. There are several sturdy hearts, just like that girl, scattered all over the world. In Malala, in Pakistan, in Shaibu, that's Leah, in Nigeria, and tens of thousands that are nameless. Such matters should not exist. That is the troubling mandate of our existence. Children should not be burdened with such an unconscionable dilemma. They should never undergo the horrors of a Beslan, nor be presumably purified by furnaces that repeatedly consume them through the agency of mindless fundamentalism, nor indeed from any other cause. They should not be so brainwashed nor coerced that they turn into walking bombs, their young limbs turn into projectiles, slicing through marketplaces, motor parks, churches, and even mosques, and after forcible abduction. So with that quick, brutal resume of the plight of millions of our vulnerable species, what it attempts to do is simply to inculcate, to suggest this, that what might appear to be an innocuous intervention in the permissive mode in such situations often goes beyond a mere academic exercise whose purpose, deliberate or unintended, is the distancing of horror. It contributes building blocks towards the mental and physical accommodation of the enemy within and the consolidation of the culture of both impunity and triumphalism. Where such abnormalities occur, or even merely threatens, the language of understanding or rationalization becomes an obscenity. It is even blasphemous. And, as we are harshly taught repeatedly, to use a familiar expression, you never know when the chickens will come home to roost. We are not the state whose responsibility it is to secure its own citizens by the nearest and handiest means and establish the safety and dignity of its subjects. Yet, it is those like us, citizens in name, who undergo the burgeoning arrogance of such religious imperialism. For that is what we appear to confront in widening swathes of the world these days and in an aggressively apocalyptic mode. What we can do on behalf of humanity, however, is to broaden the perspectives of that assailed humanity that finds itself under siege by opening ourselves to alternative worldviews that contradict the oppressive certitudes of the dominant worldviews, no matter how deeply entrenched those views may be in general consciousness, and no matter the overwhelming, however overwhelming, the seductive structures that sustain them, be those in the form of architecture, their devotional arts, including music, sculptural and figurative representations, even their poetry and ceremonials. The consecrated habits of millennia are not easily upturned, and why should they be? But they can be taught to coexist with others, or at the very least, guide perceptions towards possible extractions of overlooked lessons from them. And if antiquity is itself a repository of some such values, then perhaps we should query backwards, at least occasionally. Such extracts, after all, have only been supplanted by time, and let us concede it, by superior organizations sometimes, superior marketing forces and techniques, including rhetoric, liturgy, and iconic seduction, but most often by superior force of arms. That is where we have a right to question even evocation of attributions such as world religions. Truths are not necessarily embedded in the geographical spread or numerical strength of the followers of any doctrine, theocratic or secular. Sometimes the contesting cry of small is beautiful actually translates as small is truthfulness. Not necessarily always, but indisputably, sometimes. The neglected invites exploration, especially where the immense, the monumental, proves again and again, not merely flawed, but anti-human in its manifestations. It's so readily conducive to negative conversion and blatantly self-contradictory in its own tenets. If I claim that my religion is a religion of peace, and then that religion becomes justification for the slaughter of children and their conversion to sexual serfdom, there already exists some innate contradiction there that challenges rational in the human. In a universe that offers us active models of mutual accommodation between Ogun and St. Anthony, Shokmano and Aesculapius, Ishu and Apollo, Olokun and Neptune, Pluto and the ancestor world, Venus and Cloacina, within the same conceptual frame and symbolic representation, all further argument becomes superfluous. Does the world really need deity, singular or plural? That, however, is not the question. The real question is, in whose image is or are they created? Thank you very much.
Professor Shoinka, se volete, può rispondere due domande. Se avete domande da fare, anche in italiano, poi traduciamo noi. Se volete.
They are very shy. All of them are very shy. I have a short question, just one short question. We understand that this syncretistic background is the one which you indeed offer us as a kind of solution for having in mind all of us, having in mind our deities, which easily become one deity, which become in turn the deity which are imposed upon other deities or upon other images, so disfiguring other people's faces, basically. This large quantity of images that is created through syncretic thinking is not easy to keep. So is there a sort of recipe, very quick recipe, for us to have such a polyform pantheon?
Well, the first thing is syncretism itself is only is the result of a spiritual temperamental accommodation. So syncretism itself is not necessarily the answer. It's just a phenomenon which I think offers a doorway towards the thinking for human cohabitation. You can have simultaneously, and shall we say that people can even take spiritual insurance, as happens in many societies which are presumably, which the missionaries think have been totally converted. No, you'll find people in, I'm sure not in Nigeria alone, they will go to the mosque on Fridays, they go to Seventh-day Adventist on Saturday, they will go to church on Sunday, and on the festival days of the Orisha, you will see them also at the front. That's what I call spiritual insurance, just in case. But it's not a bad thing, because it means through that you also enter the cultural practices of others, and that is the main thing. You enter their worldviews, their alternative ways of thinking. So it's a very easy process, as long as one doesn't think that it has to be emerging of sensibilities. No, it can just be a complementarity in which one does an internal comparative study and learns to use that as a doorway into other people's essence.
It's tantamount to saying what Woody Allen would say, thank God I'm an atheist, isn't it? Thank you very much indeed. Let's say an applause.
Grazie a tutti e buonasera.